Assalamu alaikum, which means peace be with you. Peace and the mercy and blessings of God be with all of you. Thank you for watching EOAZ Television. You're watching Community Roundup. I'm your host for this episode, your brother Shabir Ali. You may have seen me elsewhere on YouTube and on television, but here I am to share some thoughts with you on the question of marital bliss. How do we achieve marital bliss and problems and questions related to divorce? Let's deal with that. But I would like to introduce the fact that we have here a special guest visiting all the way from Pakistan, and he is a very educated person. He has a PhD from the University of Wales, following from his PhD thesis, which is published in this massive tome entitled History of the Quran. He is no other than Dr. Shehzad Saleem. He is a fellow of Al Mawrid Institute in Pakistan and also a student of Javed, Ahmed, Ghamidi. Now, he has translated from the Mizan by the Sheikh Javed Ahmed Ghamidi, this book entitled Islam, A Comprehensive Introduction. And much of what is in this book is what we'll be discussing here on our program of Community Roundup. So let me talk to our guest, Dr. Shehzad Saleem. Dr. Saleem, welcome again to EOAZ Television and Community Roundup. So, for our topic now, we want to look at some of the problems that Muslims face living as new citizens of a new land, trying to live our faith in a very different environment. We want to achieve marital bliss. Mm-hmm. That's what we all want. Mm-hmm. How do we achieve marital bliss? What are the steps we have to put in place to be sure?
So, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, I would say that as far as marital bliss is concerned, it's a huge target that we need to achieve, and it's not that easy to achieve. It keeps eluding us. But there are some pointers that I would like to allude to, which might help marital bliss or coming closer to that marital bliss. The first of these pointers is, I would call it forbearance. Forbearance here, in my view, is that each of the spouses gives accommodation to each other. It bears the brunt of each other's personality. You accept that the other person is a complete human being, can have a separate set of habits, which you have to accept. And things as small as how you could turn on the light, or what channel are you going to view, or what's going to be the color of your bedroom. I mean, they're very small. Or, for example, should I snore or not when I'm living with my partner, of course, or my spouse. So these are the things which they come in a package. And when you marry a person, always remember that before marriage, that person will appear very differently. But once you get married to that person, he or she is going to have a particular set of habits. So the first point to make marital bliss is you must accommodate the other person's personality and think that he or she is an independent whole who has his or her own tendencies, which, like your own, is something if you expect her to put up with, then you might as well do that yourself. The second point I would like to make here is friendship. That try to develop friendship with your spouse, although I know it's the most difficult thing in the world. But again, you see, this is how we have to train ourselves. Who is a friend? A friend is a person you can fall back upon. A friend is a person who encourages you. He does not score points against you, or she does not score points against you. A friend is a person, as they say, who's always there for you in need. So develop that friendship. And the pinnacle of that friendship is to become soulmates. If you can become soulmates of one another, then this is nothing like it, but it's not always achievable. The third thing which might be very helpful in this regard, of course, is forgiveness. You see, whenever two people or more than two people live in the same roof, under the same roof, there's going to be discrepancies, there's going to be differences of opinion, and there are going to be mistakes which are being made by people. So you have to be magnanimous. You must forgive your spouse for small things which take place out of, at times, ignorance, at times you're inadvertent, you're not intending to do something. So the third point is that you should be forgiving as much as possible, because it is in forgiveness which lies the key to coming close to each other. It develops a lot of trust when you know that your partner or your spouse is not going to go against you. And fourth, and finally, and of course, I just count them, all of these are F, so forgiveness or friendship or forbearance. So another F is fidelity. And people actually relate this to marital fidelity of not actually having that extreme relationship with outside marriage. I say that fidelity starts with the eye and your feelings in the heart. So you must be devoted to your wife. And come what may, it is at times some deficiency in your spouse that makes you look outside. You have to realize that if there is some deficiency in your spouse, you yourself have the same thing. You're also deficient in some way, and the other person would be thinking in the same way. So it's not that you have to, you must concentrate on the abilities and the qualities of your spouse, remain devoted to him or her, and never look outside that bond of marriage. And that starts with the eye. When you start staring at other women or other men in a manner which is not proper, it is here that your heart tends to take liberty. And finally, another F coming up, and that is feedback. So it's very good if you take periodic feedbacks from your partner, from your spouse. Let yourself be acquainted with how he or she feels about you, because that is a feedback which is being given to you from someone who is 24/7, 365 with you. And perhaps it could be a little exaggerated, because you see, you tend to get annoyed as well, but then you get the crux of it. So I would say these five things: friendship, fidelity, forgiveness, forbearance, and finally feedback. All these five F's, if we are able to adhere to them, they could be means to attain that marital bliss which keeps eluding us.
That's amazing, the way you've put it as the 5 points there. So let me see if I can remember the 5 points now. So one is
forbearance.
Forbearance.
Forgiveness.
Forgiveness.
Friendship.
Fidelity
and feedback.
Okay, so there you go, folks. Just in 5 points, how to have your marital bliss. But wait, we're not done, Dr. Saleem. These are excellent points, and even if a non-Muslim were watching this show, they would say, yeah, that all makes sense. Some Muslims may be thinking, well, that's all great the way it sounds, but does any of this come from the Quran and from the life example of our Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him?
Well, I think that, as I said, if you study the Quran and the seerah of the Prophet, you'll find all these five aspects interspersed. The Quran says that this marriage is a union of souls, and he has placed rahma and mawadda between the souls. So this mawadda and rahma is actually a broad heading or a title. And if I can say that these 5 points are basically an explanation of that mawadda, which means love and rahma or compassion. So this is like the strategy to achieve that love and compassion. But other than that, the life of the Prophet, there are so many incidents which I couldn't quote, which perhaps the lack of time would not allow me to, but there are so many incidents in which the Prophet exercised this wisdom with his wives, in which he was compassionate, in which he showed forbearance. He accepted the personality of his wife. He even joked with them. At times he would realize that his wives are at a certain point of time, have a certain view, and it's not always possible to convince some of your views immediately, so you should maybe step back, give them time. And so there are numerous instances in his life when he showed this friendship element, this fidelity element, of course, was never ever missing. And then the fact that he would forgive a lot of things. We have that famous incident in which he was visiting one of his spouses, he was presented with a sweet dish, and that sweet dish was sent by another spouse with whom he had spent the previous day, and that was bought in a pot of clay and presented to the Prophet. And the wife with whom he was, she became very angry, and she said, well, she has already had her turn. Why is she sending more food? So it is said in Bukhari, this narrative says that that wife became so angry that she just threw that pot on the floor and it just crashed to pieces. And look what the Prophet did. He said, okay, if this is going to cause a scene, he just picked up a new pot from the shelf and gave it to that person and said, just go and give this back to you. So that it should not be presented in a way as if it was not acceptable to her and she caused that whole the whole thing to break. And you see, it was here that he actually thought that these are common human emotions. And as human emotions, they do come into play. But instead of dwelling on these emotions and sort of narrating them and reporting them, it's much better to forgive them or to just put them under the carpet. Because as human beings, we are human.
Dr. Saleem, some of our viewers are youth who are not yet married, and we often hear from the imams in the khutbahs that you have to plan for your marriage, and to have a blissful marriage, you have to even think before you get married, who is a suitable person for you to get married. Mm-hmm. What advice do you have for the youth in terms of selecting a suitable life mate?
Well, I think I would give, my advice would be that if your partner has two qualities, and one of them is that he or she is a seeker of the truth, and he or she is a person who would like to find out what the truth is on the basis of reasoning and knowledge, then I think any person who has these qualities is someone who is a very basic candidate. And then other than that, of course, if the person is a God-fearing person, if a person, his and your interests or her or your interests are the same, that's of course something which is of a boon. But if a person is not bigoted, if he or she is not biased towards something, is always open to discussion, always after the truth, to him or her, the biggest thing is the truth, and he or she is the seeker of the truth, I think that is something which takes us out of so many botherations and so many problems, because that is the line that we are required to pursue. And God has said that if you are a seeker of a truth, even if you end up on the wrong side of the truth, God Almighty is still going to honor you because you tried your best. You were sincere to your cause. And I think that is the thing that matters the most.
Well, we only have a very short time left for this part of today's episode before we take a break and come back for more. But let me see if we can remember the 5 points before we leave, because that's very precious. Uh-huh. So it's forbearance.
It's forbearance.
Fidelity.
Forgiveness.
Friendship. And
Feedback.
Okay. So one of the issues that we face a lot in Canada, Dr. Saleem, is that we find that there is a rise in the rate of divorce. And this is new to many Muslims because mm-hmm. we have tended to live in traditional societies. Mm-hmm. And those societies formed a very strong impetus towards mm-hmm. keeping the families together mm-hmm. Despite difficulties that are there in the relationship. Here, being in a free and open society, which has its positive aspects, mm-hmm. One of the negative fallouts we are finding from this is that there is a rise of divorce among Muslims. So
right.
I want to get your thoughts about that. And folks, there are many problems and questions that we face in this regard. So after the break, I'd like to talk to Dr. Saleem and with all of you about the problem and questions arising out of divorce. I am your host for this episode, Shabir Ali. You're watching Community Roundup on Awaz Television. And I have with me a guest visiting all the way from Pakistan, Dr. Shehzad Saleem. I turn to him now to talk about the unfortunate problem of divorce after we just talked about how to have a blissful marriage. This is the flip side of it when things mm-hmm. go sideways. So, Dr. Saleem, what are your thoughts on this problem that I introduced just before the break? Here in Canada, we are finding a rise in the rate of divorce, and mm-hmm. while we used to look at those statistics and thinking that this is a problem mm-hmm. among non-Muslims, now we're finding that this is a problem among Muslims as well. What are your thoughts on that?
So I would say that a number of points can be made, but one of the things which has arisen in the last maybe two decades is that women have become more empowered. They are now professionals. Maybe 40 years ago or three decades ago, that was not the case. They were entirely dependent on the husband for their financial income. And if the husband was a tyrant or if he was a bad person, she had no option but to opt and stay with him. Another thing would be children would be born. And of course, that would be a big shackle or a fetter for them to come out of this bond. But today, when they are getting empowered, and at the same time, they find that the attitude of their husband, and I, being a husband myself, I do think I have an equal blame, and I have equal blame to share, that we husbands at times tend to be dictatorial in our ways, and we don't, as I said earlier on, that one of the keys to marital bliss is forbearance, is to give respect and give the other person the status that she is a human being who has her own set of habits and that they must be respected. So what we do is that we try to impose our opinion on our spouse. And more often than not, that causes a lot of disruption because women no longer are in the mood to accept your dictatorial tendency. Formerly they were because they were compelled to do so. But today, when they are empowered, when they know that they can earn their own living, even they can take their children along with them, so they are not going to put up with any nonsense if it comes from their spouse. And I think that Muslim men here need to take stock of a lot of things that they do, because a lot of these things that they do come out of the culture that they have been living, or their parents have been living when they were in the East, in Pakistan or in Nepal or in India, where there is a certain reverence given to the husband. He is like a god in the house, and he cannot be disobeyed. You cannot sit with the husband. You have to talk to him in a very respectful way. So I think that those Eastern traditions still have some reflection in the minds and the houses of people who are Desis, who have come all the way to Canada or to the US, but they still linger on. So yes, I agree with you, and I think the solution to this is introspection, and I think this introspection has much to do with the Muslim husband, and he must realize that there is something wrong, because he's in a certain position. He is the head of the family. And whenever something goes wrong, you remember, as a rule, I always blame the head of the family or the head of any person who's in charge of something. Because when something is given in your responsibility, you are more responsible for that. So as husbands are in charge, or they are the heads of the family, they have to realize that what is the thing that they're doing. And also, we must not forget how the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the last sermon actually advised Muslim men that these women are given in your responsibility. Ashiruhunna bil ma'ruf, as the Quran also says, you must live with them in a way which pleases them, which is according to conventions, which is good in all the way. But I think that it is here that we are really falling short, and we must take stock, and we must come up to the situation.
Mm-hmm. So Dr. Saleem, as much as we will take stock and try to prevent the unfortunate circumstance of divorce, but being human beings as we are, it's going to happen,
right.
Sometimes at least. We hope it doesn't happen that much. But when it does happen, or it's going to happen, what's the procedure to be followed? Because Muslims are quite vague about this. We don't think about it, because we don't expect it's going to go down that route. We get married, we're all happy, it's a lot of celebration, a lot of happiness, and then eventually things go sideways, and then we don't know how to deal with it. What is the procedure for getting a divorce?
So if you study the Quran, it says that, of course, this marriage union must be a union which is of benefit to both. But obviously, as you said, there are instances in which this cannot be pulled along. And in spite of a lot of effort from both sides, you find that it's better to separate ways or to part ways. So the first step which the Quran lays out is that if there are differences of opinion, if they cannot be resolved by the husband and the wife, then an arbitrator should be appointed. Hakama min ahlihi wa hakama min ahliha. One from the side of the husband and one from the side of the wife, so that if they are not able to resolve their own differences, one chance should be given to the elders of the family or to the society in general. If they can make sense or talk sense into them, maybe they are able to help them out. So before pronouncing divorce or going for that extreme step, the Quran says the matter should go into arbitration, and two representatives, one each from the spouses, should sit together and try to see. And if they are also convinced, of course, that there's going to be there's no way out, it is then that the Quran says then you have to pronounce that divorce. And that divorce must not be in rage. It must not be in anger. It must not be because you're suddenly in a fit of frenzy out of something which has happened. It should be a calculated thing. You and your spouse have decided that there's no way that we can pull along. So let's sit down as friends and part ways. And the procedure which the Quran has laid out for that is that one divorce should be pronounced. After that, the lady has, of course, her 3 menstrual cycles to wait. And within one period of marriage, in that menstrual cycle, or 3 menstrual cycles, the husband has the authority of restitution, which is ruju. If he decides to take back his decision, he has all the authority to do so. But if the iddat period passes, which is 3 menstrual cycles, then he and she both are independent human beings, and she can go her way, and of course he can go his way. So that is a very simple procedure. And of course, if at some other time they think that things have gone better, they can remarry. And that is why the Quran says that one divorce should be pronounced. Because if you pronounce more than one divorce, of course, there is a misuse of pronouncing all these 3 divorces, or in pronouncing them in a fit of rage, then the Quran says this is not the right way. Do it in a calculated way so that if you pronounce a divorce and the lady becomes a free lady after the iddat period, you can always marry her again.
Mm-hmm. So one of the problems we notice is that men in a fit of rage or whatever, he just authors divorce multiple times at once. And then the families then come to the imams and they say, well, here's our problem. This divorce was uttered multiple times, but really we would like to live together as husband and wife. Maybe we were angry with each other at that time, but what do we do now? Is there a solution for that?
So we have a very clear example from the Prophet's life in that, and we know that once when Rukana ibn Abdayazid, the companion, pronounced a number of divorces, and he became afraid that, oh, this will separate my wife, and he came to the Prophet, and the Prophet asked him that, did you intend to give this, or well, you have some different intention? He said, no, it was just in a fit of frenzy, I didn't have that intention. So the Prophet asked the intention of the person. So if this, which gives us this guidance, that if this thing occurs in a fit of rage and you actually don't intend what you say, but you see when you're angry, you say all sorts of things. So a person who is the arbitrator or the judge or the mufti, whoever he is, he should ask the intention of the person. Was it you really wanted to do that, or it was just came out of your mouth? And if he says that the intention was not that, then we must go by the intention. We can, of course, ask him to give his word for that. We can even corroborate from the wife as well. But it's the intention which ultimately counts, and anything which comes out of rage is not at all something which should be relied upon.
Mm-hmm. Now, you've pointed out that in the Canadian society, women feel that they have more rights and freedoms and so on, and naturally that they will not put up with, as you called it, nonsense from the husband. Now, let's say a woman wants to be out of her marriage. Now, this presents its own difficulty for her because generally, it is thought that it's the man's right to call the divorce, not the woman's right. Is there a way out for women?
So the Quran says that men and women have an equal right to divorce. The only thing is men give divorce and women seek divorce. So the procedure would be, if a woman wants to come out of this marriage bond, she will say that I would like to get out of the bond, so please give me divorce. So a husband would have his own, for example, time to convince her, to persuade her, but if he thinks that things cannot be pulled along, then the demand of the wife is final. He cannot override that. And that is why we say that women have an equal right. Only the procedure is different. For example, men will give a divorce and women will seek a divorce, but both have an equal right. So men will just write down that divorce and it will happen. And women will ask the man to give her the divorce. So it will be always initiated from the man. But the right to divorce is absolutely equal. If she wants to step out, she has the authority, she will ask him, and every gentleman should do that, what is implied. But if there is a dispute, then of course she can take the matter to court, and this happened in the time of the Prophet as well. And the Prophet separated people merely because they wanted. For example, there is this famous incident which took place in which a woman came to the Prophet and she said that she did not like to remain in this marriage bond. And the Prophet said, what? Why? And she just took out of her hijab, and she, of course, she was a very beautiful and a very graceful lady, and the person was not that handsome. And she said, I might get into some fitna because of this fact. And merely on this basis, without even going further, the Prophet just had them separated. So you see, as far as the reason for separation or divorce is concerned, that's your personal choice. But once it is made, then the other person is, especially the husband, must honor it.
Now, in a Canadian context, there is no qadi or judge of a Muslim label. So if a woman wanted to seek a divorce in our context, so who would they approach to get this done?
I think the way the law is stated here, the way they go to a court and they approach it, the court, I think it's in line with the Islamic principles. It is only that the husband should not resist at that time. The pre-resistance period should be the one in which they should try to persuade each other that let this not happen. But if it is ultimately destined to happen, then whatever procedure is adopted by any country in which the court gives this ruling is perfectly okay, because that they would be acting on behalf of the husband in either annulling the marriage or in making him ask to divorce, whatever the law is.
Now, there is something that is mentioned in the classical Islamic law about the mahar, which is the dower that is paid from the husband to the wife at the time of marriage. How does that play out if indeed there is a divorce?
So as far as the Quran is concerned, it says that this should never be the case, that once you give this dower, you should take it back in any situation, even if you have to seek divorce, except for two cases. One, if a woman is guilty of adultery, or, and second, if a husband is merely not giving divorce to that lady because he thinks that he has gifted her a lot of property and assets, and if he is going to take the, he's going to divorce her, he's going to lose that part. So it is here that the woman is told that if you want to come out of that marriage bond, because he's not divorcing you simply because he has gifted you a lot of money other than dowry, then that is something which a woman can do. As far as dowry itself is concerned, that is something which is unspoken of. I mean, it is beyond any question that that should be taken back. So in both cases, dowry is the right of the woman. I am talking about another case in which something is gifted by the husband to the wife, and it is because of that that he is not divorcing her, because in some good moment he gives that a lot of assets to that wife, and now he's thinking of, she's thinking of walking out on him. So it is here that the Quran says that fi maftadat bihi, if she wants to get out of that bond and give that gifted part back to the husband so that he's at peace with these assets, then that is allowed.
It's a very interesting discussion. Excellent thoughts from you, Dr. Saleem. I wish we could go on forever, but every good thing must come to an end. Folks, you've been watching Community Roundup on eAwaz TV. I've been your host for this episode, Shabir Ali. And with me was Dr. Shehzad Saleem, visiting from Pakistan. But before he leaves back and returns from Canada, I would like to have him for one more episode and you to watch that episode with us. So don't leave us hanging, but search for the next episode wherever you watch eAwaz television and Community Roundup. On the next episode, we're going to be talking about the rights and responsibilities of parents and children. How do we live as parents and children, as Muslims, in a Canadian context?